St. Peter addressed the people in Solomon's portico at the temple in Jerusalem after the time of Pentecost. He said directly, "Men of Israel, you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the Author of Life." In the service of Good Friday, we reflect on that truth, and we remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for each of us. The hymnist describes the event of poignant beauty. The shepherd dies for sheep that love to wander. Good Friday is good for us and our salvation. Please stand. O Lord, open my lips.
My mouth will declare your praise.
Make haste, O God, to deliver me.
Make haste to help me, O Lord. Praise to you, Christ, Lamb of our salvation.
He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him.
With his stripes we are healed.
Almighty God, graciously behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death on the cross, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
All we, like sheep, have gone astray.
And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all.
Almighty and most merciful God, give us grace so to contemplate the passion of our Lord, that we may find in it the forgiveness of our sins. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
beginning at verse 28 of chapter 18. And then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning, and they themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters so that they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." And this was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation, the chief priests, have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from this world." And then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. And for this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" And after he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a robber. Thus far the passion. Crucify him. Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for For I find no guilt in him. The Jews answered him, We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God. And when Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, Where are you from? But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you? Jesus answered him, You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin. From then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar. So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down in the judgment seat at the place called the Stone Pavement in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, Behold your king! And they cried out, away with him, crucify him. Pilate said to them, Shall I crucify your king? And the chief priest answered, We have no king but Caesar. So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. Thus far the Passion of our Lord.
To bottom, so that they said to one another, Let's not tear it,
but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be. And this was to fulfill the scripture which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. And so the soldiers did these things. Thus far, the Passion of our Lord. So they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. And when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Thus far the Passion of our Lord.
Thank you.
since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day. The Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. Those things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, another scripture says, they will look on him whom they have pierced. Thus far the passion of our Lord. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thank you.
also consider the prophet Isaiah chapter 53, verses 3 to 12. And you may be seated as I read that section. The prophet writes, "He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, he was afflicted, and yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many, and he makes intercession for the transgressors." Thus far in the text. Well, last Wednesday, we heard Pontius Pilate, as we heard in the Passion reading today, ask a very cynical and a rhetorical question, really. What is truth? But it turns out that he was asking the wrong question. Instead, he should be asking, who is truth? So as we gather to remember the sacrifice that Jesus Christ has made for us all, we focus on the one who is the way, the truth, and the life. Even Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. For in Jesus Christ, you have the truth incarnate in flesh. And this evening, we look on as he who is the truth hangs upon the cross. We look on as he bears the sins of the whole world to reconcile us to God the Father. And all this he does willingly for you. And so this sermon series throughout the season of Lent and Holy Week has centered on God's call through the prophet Joel for his people to return to the Lord your God. That means that you admit to your sinful nature as well as the sins that you have committed since, and you return to the one who Joel claims is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. God is the one who loves you. He is the one who provides for you, who sent his son to die for you, because he relents over disaster. And so his call again this evening is for you to return to the truth, that is to the truth of Jesus Christ, for he is your life and your salvation. While the chief priests and the scribes and the whole council had delivered Jesus over to Pontius Pilate, they were not about truth. They were pushing a lie. They were betraying their own Messiah. And they perpetuated that lie as they insisted that he had done evil and that he deserved to be punished, even punished by death. Now Pilate was on to them. He knew that they were driven by selfish motives. And yet Pilate himself was backed into the corner, and so he could not advocate for the truth. His choice was impossible. Put an innocent man to death or lose control of the town as the population erupted in a riot, and he lost his standing among Caesar. Well, everything was working according to plan, and yet it was not the plan of the chief priest. This was God's plan. He put this together, for it is a plan of salvation made necessary by mankind's fall into sin at the temptation of Satan. And part of God's plan then included a battle between the offspring of the serpent and the offspring of the woman. God's plan required that the heel of the Son of Man would be bruised so that he could crush the head of the serpent's offspring. God's plan stripped death of its power and opened the way to eternal life. And this plan would play out on the tree of the cross. Jesus was the focal point of the whole thing. Now Pilate, humanly speaking, tried to placate the accusers. He had Jesus flogged and tortured, mocked and insulted. He was beaten to within an inch of his life. Pilate thought that that would satisfy their bloodlust. But they dressed him in a purple robe in a sarcastic nod to his divinity. And then Pilate stood before the people and pointed to Jesus, this time bloody and bruised. But how could he say with a straight face, "I find no guilt in him," as if perhaps he'd been trying to beat it out of him? But the plan was already set in motion, and there would be no changing the outcome, for Jesus had to die. He had told his disciples this countless times throughout his ministry, that it was necessary for him to do so. And so the voices, they went along, "Crucify him," they said, "crucify him." And John tells us it was the chief priest and the officers who first cried out these words, getting the mob to follow their rule. No, they weren't alone. There was that crowd of people, much like you and me, everyday people. And they also screamed to have Jesus crucified. Our sinful nature rises up even as Christ demands our attention. The law prescribes our actions, and we want no part of the law. We would rather follow a lie, as did Adam and Eve, and as has every human since. "You shall have no other gods." Fine. "I'll have only one God, and that's me." This man, this Son of God, wants first place. He has to die. Crucify him. Do you want to take the Lord's name in vain? This man is blasphemed. He's made himself the Son of God. He should die as the blasphemer. Or honor the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. You can't tell me what to do. Crucify him. Honor your father and mother. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not covet. Crucify him. We chafe at God's leading. Our sinful man wants nothing to do with it because, as Romans 8, verse 7 tells us, it is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And so our sinful natures rise up before God's truth. We close our ears as it shouts, "Crucify him." We close our ears to truth and follow so easily the lie. And yet the truth is not so easily silenced. For the truth echoes in your ears even as it hangs lifeless on a cross. The truth of God slips past your defenses, and the word of God softens your heart. The truth whispers gently in your ears, "Yes, you crucified him, but that was the only way out of your sin. Someone had to die for all that you've done, and Jesus came for just that purpose." So look at the cross, look at the one who hangs on it, the one who bears your sins, who has taken your punishment. The author of creation himself hangs upon the cross, racked with pain, writhing in agony. It's almost unbearable to look on this scene. And yet without it, without this gory death, we would be lost forever. We would still be trapped in our sins. Now we heard Isaiah foretell that his appearance was so marred, it was beyond human semblance. You couldn't even recognize him. His form beyond that of the children of mankind. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. That's your God. Beaten, bruised, bleeding, suffering for you. For surely he has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows. All that we have gone through, Jesus has embodied himself. Pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. And so Jesus died for you. He carried your grief, your sorrow, your sin, your guilt. But why? Why did it have to be like this? It was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief, Isaiah says. He poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. That's your Savior, your Lord, the one who died for your sins. He makes intercession for you. He willingly poured out his soul to death so that you will have life and life in its fullest. Indeed, Jesus is, as he says, the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. And so your hearts, led by the Holy Spirit, finally relent. You see that there is no other way, that all your righteous deeds are like a polluted garment. You can't fix it. You can't be good enough. You can't be without sin. You can't win your own salvation. Whatever good you might manage to pull off is completely overshadowed by your sinful nature. With man, this is impossible, Matthew tells us. But with God, all things are possible. With God, you are saved. But someone must endure the penalty. God's wrath must be satisfied. The wages of sin must be paid. Someone has to die. Jesus is that someone. He who lived a perfect life for you, he who's taken all of your sin on himself like a silent lamb before the slaughter. He took all of it, the cross, in order to satisfy God's wrath. And in exchange, he gives you his own righteousness in return, asking only that you trust him, that you receive from him, that you leave it all to him. This evening, as we survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, I pray that you'll hear God's call to return to him, to return to truth, to trust in the one who has promised salvation and eternal life. The hymn says it well. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did ever such love and sorrow meet? Thorns compose so rich a crown? May the peace of God given through that holy, precious blood and innocent suffering and death of Jesus keep you focused on him who lived and died and rose again to win your salvation, to give to you the gift of eternal life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the prayers. Please rise.
A garden, and in the garden a new tomb
in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. Thus concludes the Passion of our Lord.